In this video, we discuss the phenomenon of over-parameterization. This phenomenon usually happens when a model has extremely huge number of parameters. In this case, the model does not usually overfit to the training data, but gaining higher performance than expected. This phenomenon contradicts to the conventional theory of machine learning. Hence, it is very important to know what is overparameterization. Here is the outline. First, I will introduce what is the cause of overfitting in the concept of traditional machine learning. In the traditional machine learning theory, the cause of overfitting usually happens when model complexity is high. However, when the model complexity is extremely high, such as deep learning model, another new phenomenon contrary to overfitting will happen. This phenomenon is called over-parameterization. Here, we first introduce the cause of overfitting in traditional machine learning. We define epsilon hat of H as the training error and epsilon of H as the testing error for a given model H. The definition of overfitting is that when training algorithm reduce the epsilon hat to become very small, but epsilon is still large. What is the cause of overfitting? Conventionally, overfitting is due to too many parameters in the model. Here we illustrate an example. The solid dots indicate the training instances, and the hollow dots indicates the testing instances. If there are too many parameters, the model H will perfectly fit all the training instances, and hence the boundary will be very complex. In this case, some of the testing instances near the boundary will be misclassified. To make the model fit the data appropriately, the number of parameters in the model should be reduced so that its boundary will be smooth. Although some of the training instances will be misclassified, however, more testing instances will be classified correctly. Here we show a theorem to explain why too many parameters will cause overfitting. Mainly, this can be explained by VC bound. This inequality will have 1 minus delta probability to be satisfied. In this inequality, the left-hand side is the testing error, the right-hand side is the training error, plus a term with square root. This term is called generalization gap, which decide the gap between the training error and testing error. Overfitting happens when the generalization gap is large. There are mainly two factors controlling this generalization gap. The first one is the number of samples denoted by n. If there are more training samples, the generalization gap will be smaller. The second term is the VC dimensions denoted by d. This term is scale with the number of parameters. The more parameters in a model, the larger the VC dimension is and more prone to overfitting. Based on this bound, we can draw the following plot. In this plot, the x-axis is the VC dimension and the y-axis is the error. The blue curve is the training error and the green curve is the testing error. When the VC dimension is equal to the number of samples, the model can perfectly classify all the training samples. Hence, the training error will be zero. This situation is called shatter. In this case, the generalization gap will be very large and severe overfitting will happen. Hence, the best VC dimension is much smaller than the number of sample in which the testing error reaches its minimum. Traditionally, to find the best number of parameters, a validation set is sampled, and the number of parameters which can reach the minimum validation error is selected. To fully understand the concept of VC dimension, we need to dive deeper into its meaning. VC dimension is a measure of model complexity. It indicates that a more complex model can learn more intricate decision boundaries. To explain the VC dimension, we first introduce the concept of the growth function. The growth function classifies the hypothesis defined by a set of model parameters into different groups. The growth function, denoted by tau, is the number of possible hypothesis groups in the hypothesis space H given a set of n training instances from x1 to xn. Let's look at an example where n equals 2, and we have a hypothesis set of a 1D classifier on a real line. There are infinite hypotheses that could position the 1D classifier to separate two training instances, x1 and x2, into the blue class and the orange class. However, these parameter sets for the 1D classifier can be grouped into four possible configurations. These configurations are classifying both points as orange, classifying the left point as orange and the right as blue, classifying the left as blue and the right as orange, and classifying both as blue. Thus, the growth function tau for the points x1 and x2 is 4. The growth function tau h is the maximum number of possible hypothesis groups given any n data points. Here, h represents the hypothesis space, and xi refers to the ith training instance. For example, consider a 2-linear classifier with 3 samples. In the figure on the left, there are 8 possible ways the hypothesis can classify the 3 points. All points blue, x1 is orange and the others are blue, x1 and x2 are orange and x3 are blue, or all points orange and so on. In the figure on the right, if all 3 points are aligned on a straight line, the hypothesis set can only classify them into 6 possible groups. The growth function tau h determines the maximum number of hypothesis groups for a given n. Thus, the growth function tau h when n equals 3 is 8. Next, we define the VC dimension. The VC dimension of a given hypothesis set, h, is the maximum number of data points that can be shattered by the hypothesis set. If n data points can be shattered by the hypothesis set, the number of hypothesis groups will be 2 to the power of n. This is because each data point can be classified into one of 2 possible classes. Therefore, for n data points, there are 2 to the power of n possible ways to assign classes. Let's look at an example. Consider the VC dimension of a 2D linear model as the hypothesis set. When n equals 3, the growth function of the 2D linear model is 8, which is equal to 2 to the power of 3. Thus, a 2D linear model can shatter 3 points. However, when n equals 4, the growth function is 14, which is less than 16, 2 to the power of 4. This means that a 2D linear model cannot shatter 4 points. The bottom row of the right figure illustrates a scenario where a 2D linear model cannot assign classifications. In this case, the blue points are in the upper left and bottom right, while the orange points are in the bottom left and upper right. Since the 2D linear model can shatter 3 points but cannot shatter 4 points, its VC dimension is 3. It is important to note that the VC dimension is independent of the distribution of data samples and the number of data samples. This is because the growth function measures the maximum possible number of hypothesis groups over n samples, x1, x2, up to xn. Similarly, the VC dimension determines the maximum number of data points that can be shattered by the hypothesis set H. Therefore, the VC dimension only depends on the complexity of the hypothesis space, H, and is independent of n and the specific data points, x1, x2, up to xn. Here we discuss what happened when we want to apply VC bound to a neural network. The VC dimension of a multilayer perception is proportional to the number of layer L and the number of total parameters W times the log of W. However, consider a toy example such as MNIST, which only contains 50,000 samples. For a simple neural network with the input layer width 784 and hidden layer width of 600, its VC dimension will be around 26 million. This VC dimension is by far larger than the number of samples, and hence this model must shutter the training samples and resulting in severe overfitting. However, the testing error of this neural network on MNIST usually can achieve less than 0.1, which is far from overfitting. The testing error is so low that the VC bound cannot adequately explain why high model complexity does not lead to overfitting. To explain this phenomenon, the work of Belkin, Mikhail et al. Proposed to extending the error curve of the traditional machine learning, shown in the following. In this plot, the x-axis is the VC dimension and the y-axis is the error. The blue line is the training error and the green line is the testing error. Conventionally, when the VC dimension is not too large, the testing error behaves as VC bound predicted. However, when VC dimension is far larger than the number of training samples, the testing error drops with the increase of VC dimension. In this region, VC bound is a very loose upper bound and could not explain the decrease of testing error. This error curve is called double descent curve, and this phenomenon is called overparameterization. The experiments on both two-layer neural networks and random forests, as shown in this work, demonstrate the double descent curve. The left figure represents the two-layer neural networks, and the right figure represents the random forests. The x-axis indicates the number of parameters, while the y-axis represents the error. The testing error, shown by the blue line, decreases as the number of parameters increases in both figures. These experiments show that overparameterization occurs not only in deep learning, but also in other models when the number of parameters becomes very large. Another study by Zhang, Chiwan, et al. Highlights the role of data distribution in overparameterization settings. In this research, the authors compare three datasets. The first dataset is the original CIFAR dataset, where the labels correspond to the correct classes, such as car being labeled as 1 and airplane as 0. The second dataset uses the same CIFAR images, but with shuffled labels, where a car might be labeled as 0, 1, or another label. The third dataset consists of random noise images. 3D deep neural networks, based on the inception architecture, were trained separately on each dataset. All three neural networks achieved zero training error. This indicates that the model complexity of these neural networks is high enough to perfectly fit all the training data. However, when considering testing error, the first dataset produced a low testing error, indicating no overfitting. In this case, overparameterization occurs. In contrast, the second and third datasets, consisting of noise, resulted in testing errors close to 0.9. This shows that overfitting occurs only when the training error is zero, but the testing error remains high. This experiment demonstrates that testing error depends heavily on the data distribution. However, the VC bound assumes the worst-case distribution and cannot account for the overparameterization phenomenon in well-labeled datasets. To conclude, here's why applying the VC bound to deep learning models is problematic. First, the VC bound assumes the worst-case dataset distribution and a model with moderate complexity. The overfitting phenomenon explained by the VC bound depends not on data distribution, but on model complexity. In deep learning, however, the datasets are usually well-labeled and far from worst-case scenarios. Moreover, deep learning models tend to have extremely high complexity. In this context, overfitting depends not on model complexity, but on data distribution. Here are the key takeaways. First, the VC bound applies when model complexity is moderate and assumes a worst-case dataset scenario. In deep learning, model complexity is extremely high, but overfitting does not always occur due to overparameterization. If overfitting does happen in deep learning, improving the quality of the training dataset is more effective than reducing model parameters. Overfitting in deep learning usually occurs because of poor data quality, not the number of parameters. Reducing noisy label in the dataset, or using better pre-processing techniques to reduce noisy features, is a much more effective strategy to reduce overfitting. Here are some suggested readings. The first is a textbook that introduces the theoretical foundations of traditional machine learning. If you are interested in deriving the VC dimension and VC bound, please refer to this book. The second is a paper that explains the double descent curve in testing error. The third is a paper discussing how data distribution affects testing error in deep learning, emphasizing the importance of good data distribution for training deep learning models. These are the key insights from the video. Thank you for listening.